When many people think of church, they think of a building that you go to on Sundays or Wednesdays. Some people think of the leaders who run the churches, and then pick a church based on which leaders they like the most. Still others think church is a collection of programs that they are a part of, serve in, and attend. They're also told to invite their friends and encouraged to give their money and time to support the work that takes place in the building. The more committed they are, the more time and money they give. Eventually, they are taught how to use their spiritual gifts to build up the church in the programs or the building where the church meets. We believe it's important for the church to gather together regularly and for people to submit to leaders and be trained and equipped by them. And we do believe that we should gather regularly so people can be equipped and built up in Christ. But we also want to send people out into the world more and more. We want them to learn how to use their money to bless people outside of the church. We want them to begin using more and more of their time to serve the city where they live. We want them to use their spiritual gifts, not just so we can benefit, but so that our city can benefit as they use their gifts for the city's good. In all of this, our hope is that we will fill our city with the presence of Christ so that gospel saturation will take place and every man, woman, and child might have an opportunity to both hear and see the good news of Jesus through his people. So I wanted to start with that. That just gives a visual. My wife actually, you know, she's lived with this for years, and she watched that. She's like, oh man, that's so much better than you. And I'm like, thanks a lot. That was me. But but for her, it's because it's visual, and she's a visual learner. And I want to let you know we have more of those kinds of videos that you can use on our saturatetheworld.com site. So if it helps you to get your people exposed to different ways of hearing and seeing this, please use them. That's what they're there for, to serve you guys in the process. And so what I want to talk about is how you do this. And I'm going to do it in a little bit of a narrative of what I've walked through this last year. So I'm going to tell you a little bit of the story I've been in, because I think sometimes story and real experiences are what connect to us in some ways the best. Some of you know that I stepped into what was Mars Hill Bellevue last year, in January. We restarted a new church called Doxa. Some of you know that Mars Hill, all the campuses, as a church, Mars Hill dissolved, and then the campuses started as new churches. The church I took over, it didn't have anybody that could lead it, partly because that was where Mark Driscoll preached live, and so they needed someone to step in who could preach and lead it, and they called me, my wife, and I, along with our elders, went through a six-week process of praying and seeking the Lord. I was called on October 21st to consider it, and we walked through a process of prayer. Our elders eventually came to a unanimous agreement that I was supposed to take the job, and then we put it in front of about 70 of our leaders of our church, and they also unanimously agreed that this was something we were supposed to do, and then we put it in front of our whole church. So it was a whole process of seeking God's will, because as you can imagine, that's a pretty significant thing to walk into, and not easy, and it was a big shift for me. So we stepped into it last year, January, and I was given the freedom, so I say all this, I want to give you caveats. I was given the freedom to lead the church where I wanted to take it. So, and we'll come back to that in a bit, because leadership has got to be able to have that. Otherwise, you can't really lead a church forward. And I was given that. Some things that were really in my favor that I want to share, just so I'm open about our transition, and you can keep that in mind, because it's always good to know the context as you listen. One, it was a church, as you probably know, that really upheld the Word of God. So I had a group of people who love God's Word, and that's really important. Hard to do this without that, I'll be honest. Second, we had a group of people who loved Jesus being proclaimed, and Mark did a good job of lifting Jesus up regularly through his preaching. And then I had a group of people who had a high view of leadership in terms of they believed they should submit to the leaders. Now, obviously, there was some brokenness in that I had to kind of deal with, and we walked through how not to put someone up too high and how not to have leadership get into a place where it could be abusive, as it became. And so those are things that I stepped into. I also stepped into a church that really heard over and over again, the mission is make disciples, okay? And so they knew that was the mission. Now how that got worked out is what we're going to talk about a little bit in terms of the transition that I've been walking through. But That was amazing. I mean, and I just say, if you've got all that, then you're in great shape for transition, because if people love the Word of God, just teach it. And I don't know how you can teach the Word of God and not end up with everyday mission. I mean, it's just everywhere there. So in fact, I think the reason why many of us don't have the idea of everyday mission, church as everyday mission, is because we probably aren't reformed enough. We aren't sola scriptura enough. We still are letting our culture, our traditions, our experiences shape our view of church maybe more than the Bible does. And so I would encourage you to, first of all, as I walk through 10 principles that I think are important for you to think about and embrace, the very first one is know that this is, first of all, a theological shift. That moving from Sunday to every day, moving from a church that primarily gathers to hear someone else do it, and moving towards being the church every day and everyone's doing it, is a theological shift. It's not just a pragmatic one. It's not just a programmatic one. It's a theological one. And the reason why I say that is because everything you do is an expression of what you believe. Your practices always reveal your beliefs. And James is the best at saying this, that I know what you believe by what you do. Your works show me your faith. The same is true for what we do as churches. So for instance, just let me walk through a kind of how I look at doing this. Is that showing up? There we go. Okay. So I work through 4 questions. I'm going to get to, just so you know where I'm going, what do we do? And how you answer what we do is completely connected to, your first of all, your theology, what you believe about who God is and what he's like, as expressed through what God has done. So we don't know anything about God apart from his revelation, okay? And so it's always what God has done tells us who God is. So we know God is a creator God because he created. We know God is communal because he revealed himself to us as Father, Son, Holy Spirit. We know God is a judge because we see him actually judge things. So we know who God is through what he's done, in particular through what he's given us in his word, inspiring it so we'd know about him. So we can't answer the who is God apart from what he's done. That's how it works. And then we come to understand who we are based upon what he's done. So everything we know about our identity should stem from our belief in who God is, what he's done. Okay, you follow the pattern? So when you think about what we do, all that we do is coming directly out of how we answer those 3 questions. Okay, so for instance, if we have a church that primarily understands its identity as gathering, and so what we do is we invite, that's connected to a view of God that primarily God is a come and see me God. Okay, you got to come to me. You got to get to me. Now, it's great if a few people invite you to come to me, but you still got to come to where I'm at. And so that come and see me view of God is maybe connected to still how you see what God did in your life, that you had to get to him. You had to pursue him. You had to figure it out. Like there's a religious movement you had to make to God versus God pursued you. God came after you. God reached you. And so if you have a view that God actually came after me, that God is a pursuing God, so God is ultimately missionary God who pursues me. We're getting used to this. There we go. So God has pursued us, and therefore I was rescued. So what then do I do? I believe that I'm now sent out like the Father sent me. So the identity of church is a sent people. And so I want you to understand that every single thing your people believe in your church is completely connected to their theology, which is developed through their Christology. That's where God is at work, where you're seeing the rule and reign, the expression of God's character. That's Christology. Being worked out in our ecclesiology, that's our understanding of church, who we are as God's people, which leads to our view of missiology, which is this last section. And if I could add one more on there, I'd say how we do it is how you contextualize what you believe, how it looks uniquely in your context, okay? Now, most of what I've seen in terms of when we have church conversations, what we should do, what we should be about, you know, what we should give our time to, most of what I see often is that we end up with largely everything to this side of the equation. We just talk about what we do and how we do it. And we don't spend much time talking about how did we ever get here? How did we ever come to the conclusion this should be the way church is done? Have any of us sat down and really wrestled with our theology expressed in our gathering, in our scattering, in our daily life, all that? And I'm not saying we haven't. I'm just saying if you don't realize that you are actually working out your theology by what you do, then you'll try to make a pragmatic or programmatic shift instead of a theological one. And you've got to make a theological one. You've got to get to the heart of why you do what you do. Now, you might say, hey, Jeff, I believe in a missionary God, an ascending God, and so, but what's going on is there's a disconnect between what you do and what you say you believe. And that's part of what God's doing in our sanctification is making sure that what we say we believe is more rightly expressed in what we do, okay? And that's what I want to talk about. How do we get there? But the reason why I started with those, does anybody need me to keep that up? You got it all? The reason why I started with that is because I run into a lot of these conversations, and it's like everybody just jumps way ahead of the theological paradigmatic shifts and go right to programmatic, and then they try something for a couple years, and it doesn't work, and then they go on to the next thing, and then the next thing, and I keep seeing churches fail to deal with the underlying problem. That is what Tim Keller calls your theological vision. So a theological vision is what you say you believe as it gets expressed in what you do as a church. He's from the PCA denomination, and he would say in their denomination, they all share the same doctrinal stance on everything, but if you go from one PCA church to another, they don't look the same. And that's the theological vision. It's how they work out what they say they believe. And so what I want to start with is if you want to shift your church, you've got to ask yourself what beliefs got us here. Like what theological principles, understandings of God's nature led us to do what we do. Flip side, please let me encourage you, start asking about everything you do, why do we do it, and how does it show what we believe about who God is, what he's done, and who we are in Christ. So regularly when I'm in a staff meeting with our team, I'll say, okay, hold on, what do we believe, and how does this express what we believe? Because if this doesn't express what we believe, we're telling our people one thing and doing an entirely different thing. A lot of us preach a gospel that our programs don't display at all. You know, like we put a lot of weight on our people to save everybody, but we preach a gospel that says you're not saved by works. So people are confused. Wait a minute, does God save or does he not? Who's the agent of salvation here? I'm not saying we shouldn't get out and share the good news. It's just how does what you preach show up in what you do so it's consistent versus it's actually contradicting itself. Make sense? So before I move on, that's the first principle. I'll talk about how I did some things in my context to deal with this. But any questions or thoughts about that before I go to the next principle? I want to give space if you need it. Hopefully that makes sense. That little grid, by the way, those four questions, I want every single believer in our church to know how to walk through that for all their behaviors eventually. Like I want them to be able to do theology, Christology, ecclesiology, and missiology. And I want them to be able to go, why do we eat the way we do? Let me tell you about who God is and what he's done and who I am in Christ, and therefore why we do what we do when we eat at the dinner table the way we do. Why do I go to work and work unto the Lord with all my heart and not work necessarily unto men? Well, because of this is what I know about God and what he's done and who I am and how we live. I want them to be able to answer those questions for every behavior eventually, not so they get overly introspective, but rather that their theology forms their life and they learn how to have an integrative theology. That's what I'm after. By the way, I'm convinced if you teach your people how to do this with everything and they know the gospel really well and they know their Bible well enough to answer the questions, you won't have to help them anymore. Like you'll actually get them to the everyday because they'll be able to be led by the word of God, by the gospel of Jesus Christ in the ways they ought to be led. Like they'll actually be able to be the church without you holding their hand forever. So the second part, and well, before I go to the second part, one of the things we did then when we started Doxa this last year is I said, I want us to think through every single thing we say and ask ourselves if we have good biblical theological, Christological foundation for why we do this. Okay, I want to know why we do what we do. I want to make sure we're faithful to the Word of God, and I want us to keep doing an audit on everything we're doing around here, making sure it fits what we say we believe. I then spent the first 3 months of the year going through what I call our foundation series, and sometimes as a church, you need to do this almost like to say, hey, restart. I'm going to do a teaching on what we believe about God, what we believe about Jesus and what he's done in the gospel, what we believe about ourselves, and what we believe about how we're going to live in light of that. So I did 12 weeks of that, and basically just said, hey, I want to give you all the opportunity to opt out if this is not the church you want to be a part of, which, by the way, I think some of us are so afraid of people leaving that we don't encourage them to go. And sometimes you have to actually invite people to have the freedom to go somewhere else. And so I just said, I know that there's one big C church in the greater Seattle area. If this isn't the church for you, I'm not going to take that personally. I just want to make sure you're in a good church that preaches the word, that lifts up Christ. But here's who we are, and here's how we're going to live, and I'm going to let you know why we're going to live this way, and you get to decide whether or not this is the church you want to continue to be a part of. I wanted to give them the opportunity. Now, I was in a unique situation because it was a bit of the explosion center of all that happened, and so, you know, they kind of expected me to come in and say that. But what I usually say to most leaders is you should try to create kind of an expectation in your church that your church is going to get replanted regularly. Okay, in fact, the reformers used to say that they said the church is always reforming. And so we should expect it that it's not right yet. We should expect there's still things that are wrong about it. And so we need to convince our people that we haven't arrived, so that way when we make changes, they're not surprised by it. Now, by the way, if you think you've arrived and you've created an arrogant culture that's like, no, we're the best in town, everything we've always done has been so good, you'll have a harder time changing your church because they won't have the humility to change. So I was in a situation, which I probably should have added, that was significantly humbled by what happened, and so they were open, you know, and that's part of it. But I did that for 12 months, and then I decided my first series would be 1 Peter, and I called it Church Everywhere. And I wanted to make sure that I taught from the scriptures who we are as God's people. And 1 Peter's great for that in terms of it being a scattered people who are living stones in the region, like I shared earlier. And so it was a really good series to go through to say, what does it look like to be the church everywhere, particularly in a place where they're going to get persecuted? And so we walked through 1 Peter, but I did that very intentionally in light of the way I wanted to form our people in light of the Bible and what it says about who God is and what we are. In light of what he's done. So make sure those of you who are preachers or teachers in the room that your teaching and preaching affirms the direction you want to go. Don't see preaching and teaching as just something you have to do because it's what you do on Sunday. See it as the way in which you cast a theological vision to your church about who God is, what he's done, and who they are in Christ. So I took them through 1 Peter. I'm going to come back to the 1 Peter series because some of the other principles I'm going to give you I want to highlight, but that's where we started. And we spent the rest of the year in 1 Peter until last fall. Well then, and this is the thing I want to encourage you to think through, as you're leading anybody through transition, you got to create a lot of feedback loops. So I had all kinds of people who were letting me know, how are the people receiving it? How are they understanding it? What's confusing? What's clear? Where's their pushback? Where are they frustrated? And so I was listening a lot to as many people as possible, not to be a people pleaser, but to be a good leader who had my ear to the ground so I could know how people were doing with everything. And I wasn't going to change my direction in terms of my convictions, but I did need to change how I led them there, because that's what good leadership does. And so let me give you an example of one of the ways I had my ear to the ground. Someone said, hey, you keep saying that Doxa is all about the mission, and the mission is making disciples, and we're called to make disciples. And I said, yeah. And they said, well, that's not any different than what was said before. So what's different? And I realized that I had to realize that sometimes language is confusing if you're using the same language someone else used to communicate a different idea. So in my case, when they said we are called, the mission of Mars Hill is to, you know, exalt Jesus and make disciples, what they heard was, invite them to Sunday where they'll come to faith in Jesus and Mark will disciple them through his preaching. And I'm not in any way downplaying Mark. Please don't hear that. That's what they heard. That's what they did. So they, and a lot of people came to faith, praise God. So I'm not disparaging any of that. But they didn't get developed. In fact, what people told me is, we don't know how to make disciples. We know how to invite people to where they become a disciple. In other words, a follower of Jesus, a brand new baby. But they didn't know how to help grow them up in the faith to become a disciple maker. So then, because I'm listening and I'm paying attention to culture and language, I finally said, okay, we are called to be disciple-making disciples. I had to add that in there, that little piece. And then what I said is, what I mean by that is, though some will come to faith on our Sunday gathering, we want to see more people coming to faith all week long through you. You're the ministers of this church. And then I started using other language. And this is, by the way, a way that you have to transition a culture. You have to change the language of the culture, or you have to redefine the present language. So if you don't realize how important language is, you will miss this one. But like I would say regularly, when people come to our gathering, hi, I'm Jeff, I'm one of the elders here. Okay, that's a key phrase I said, I'm one of the elders, because I wanted to help them see there's a plurality of leadership and I'm not the guy in the top of the chart, okay? I'm just one of them. I give my time to preaching and teaching, and then I'd usually say, we're so glad that you decided to gather with the church this week. We don't go to church around here, we are the church, but if you don't yet know Jesus, then I want to invite you to eventually become the church, because through faith in Jesus Christ, you become the church of Jesus Christ, which means you're sent to the world to be the church to the world. And if you don't yet know him, we hope that the church is going to you more than we're expecting you to come to us. So I'd say something like that, okay, a different way each time. Then I might say when we're doing our giving, after I preach, we respond through three ways: giving, communion, singing. And I'll tell you about the communion piece in a bit. But the giving part, by the way, hopefully you see what I'm doing. I'm taking what already exists and using it to change the culture instead of completely getting rid of what exists and starting all over again, which is one of my concerns for some churches. They're like, let's just scrap everything and start over. Good luck. Like, don't get rid of your primary communication tools, shaping tools, informing tools. And for us, Sunday was done so well at Mars Hill, I would be foolish to just get rid of it. I need to use it to help mobilize our people. So I would, at our giving spot, I'd say, hey, in light of what God, we just heard about God's generosity in Jesus Christ, we're going to now respond in giving to the work of seeing more people equipped to be ministers of the gospel. And sometimes I'll say this, you may not know this, but you're not paying me to do ministry, you're freeing me up to equip you to be the ministers. So this is why you give, so I can equip you, so our team can equip you to be the church all week long. Our job is to train you, so you're giving to help us equip you. So I'd say that, so it's like just one more moment, I would speak another word that they need to hear about who they are as the church and what our mission is. Then at the end of our gathering, we have a benediction. And the benediction's probably not unlike most of ours, is a spirit-empowered filling to go out and live the mission all week long. So those are all things that are coming through a theological shift. And my message, by the way, has in it all the who God is, what has he done, who are we, and how do we live. It's all in it. So I expect my message to keep forming them in their identity in Christ to lead them out on mission. And I'm just doing that every single week without fail. I probably do fail, but I don't want to fail at doing that every week. So that's a big part, a theological shift. And you've got to start thinking through all the ways you teach your people theology, Christology, ecclesiology. And you're doing it in lots of ways. Your announcements are doing it. You know, like, hey, we're a family around here. That's why we get together during the week, to love one another. So if you haven't yet experienced what it means to be family as church, you need to be a part of a missional community, because that's how we live out being a family. Or, you know, we believe the church is the missionary people of God, and so there's some opportunities this week where we can get out to share the gospel with our neighbors and our friends. We want you to join us this week. And every announcement gets connected to your theology. You keep saying it over and over and over again, because so eventually they're like, oh my goodness, this is all you ever talk about. Yes, you're getting it, okay? So there's a theological shift. Second, it's got to be a whole church shift, okay? A whole church shift. It's not just a program addition. I see a lot of people go like, well, let's just tack on missional communities to what we already have. What that means is your people are probably already too busy to do it. And so really, they're just going to get worn out and exhausted, and you're really going to have to rethink the whole paradigm of your church and what you do. When I was at Willow Creek, you guys probably, some of you figured out that was the church I was referring to this morning. When I was there as a student ministries director, I remember our people had to commit to five things. There were five G's. Grace, which is invite your friends that don't know Jesus to Sunday morning. Growth, which is be involved in Wednesday night teaching. That was when John Ortberg was teaching. Groups, be in a small group. Gifts, where you use your spiritual gift in another ministry in the church. And then giving, where you give your finances, of course. And that one doesn't necessarily require another night. But you can see there's four programmatic commitments you made in those five G's. So what we found at Willow Creek was people were too busy to even have time to meet a non-believer and be a friend of them. And so the evangelism temperature around Willow significantly dropped those last 10 years between probably about 95 and 2005, somewhere in that range. And some of you know that they actually did a study about whether or not they were actually making disciples called the Reveal Document, and they showed that they were not making disciples and in a sense repented of 30 years of not making disciples. Now, that's some humility, by the way. Like, most people don't admit that, especially when you're like the flagship church for a lot of churches. But they did, and then they said, we got to figure out how to get there. Now, I left after that. I wasn't there when they worked through how they're going to fix it. But I will tell you this, it wasn't a program problem. It was a paradigm problem. The paradigm, and you might go like, who are you to say that? Well, I might be wrong, but I think I'm right. The paradigm was that you hire staff to do ministry for the church, and then you help people get relationally connected to people in their city so they can bring them to the things that are going on at the church. That's the paradigm, okay? It's still the paradigm, and they're doing, I'm not saying there isn't great stuff going on there. Please don't hear that. However, you probably won't spend 5 or 10 years there and know how to go to another part of the world and start a church or be a disciple making disciple, because you can't reproduce Willow. It's really hard to do. It's amazing work that's being done in Chicago. I don't want to in any way disparage it. But there's a paradigm shift that needs to take place, and that is, until people know they're going to run a marathon, they don't get in shape. Right? I mean, you guys know what I'm talking about? If you told your church, all of you are leaving in 5 years to either go start another church in another part of the city or go to another part of the world, their training paradigm would shift immediately. They'd either leave your church because they don't want to be a part of it, or they go, man, we are not going to be ready if we don't start getting in the Word, learning how to pray, getting in relationship, learning how to make disciples and make disciples. I ran the Chicago Marathon a few years back. It's the only race I've ever run in my life. Figured if I do that, I don't have to run another one because I can just say I did it. And I've never trained like that. I mean, I played college sports, but there's a different kind of training for a marathon than it is for like playing soccer. And so I read runners magazines. I studied dietary practices. I need to get in, like, eat the right food, wear the right clothes, know how long you can run on a pair of shoes before you wear them out, figure out what clothes chafe in certain spots. You know what I'm talking about? So it's like, I learned stuff I would have never learned. And I'll tell you, after I ran the Chicago Marathon, I didn't order another runner's magazine. And I did, like, because I'm not running another marathon. Amen. Right? I'm done. Over. No more need to. But here's the thing that I find. Most Christians don't believe they're going to run a marathon. They don't have anything in front of them that requires them to get trained, because they know they can always fall back on someone doing the majority of it for them. And I'm not saying that there's evil intent in that at all. I'm just saying, if you want your people to get into the kind of shape that the Apostle Paul says we should get them into, which is we present everyone mature in Christ, everyone can run the race, everyone can be like a farmer, everyone can be like a soldier, then we've got to actually tell them there's a battle out there, there's sowing to be done, and there's a race to run. And until we get that in front of them, I don't think that they're going to get in shape. So that comes back to what you do as a church. So, for instance, the reason why I say it's a whole church shift, if the majority of what you do is continue to do the ministry for the people, then you'll continue to have a paradigm that says, come and let us do it for you. If you stop gradually doing all the ministry for the people and expecting the people to start doing the ministry, then eventually they're either going to leave or adjust over time. And so I recommend you start to think through, do we need to make a paradigm shift towards a church of ministers versus a church of attenders? And there's a lot of ways to do that. We can talk through some of them, but I'll tell you a few that I did at Doxa. One of them I said, guys, what we're going to do around here, and this is a third point actually, is we're going to hire equippers, not ministers. So we're not paying anybody to do ministry anymore. Now, you do ministry because you're a Christian and you're an example to the flock, but we're not paying you to do ministry. We're paying you to equip ministers or to administer. So administers and equippers are the only people we pay at Doxa. The reason why is because as soon as I pay ministers, so if I pay someone to lead worship on Sunday, then I pretty much told everybody that I know should also be leading worship that they got to get paid to do it too. But if I say, no, I'm paying someone to be a lead worshiper who's an example of a worship leader who also is equipping many people for worship, not just in bands that we're going to create, but also in our city through all the arts, and in every one of our missional communities, we train up people to be worship leaders in their missional community. Now I've got tons of worshipers that are being equipped versus one who's doing it for us every Sunday. So we can have a lot of worship leaders. Okay, so that's an equipper. An administer is somebody who gets stuff out of the way so ministry can happen better. A diaconal kind of work. Like, what's getting in the way of what is not helping us love people well, serve people well, minister to people well? And so we want those people also to be freed up so that more ministry can happen by the body. And that's the key. So that was one of the shifts I made. Another shift I made is I told our team, what do you think a mature Christian should be able to do? And if you're doing what a mature Christian should be able to do for them, you better not be doing it for them very long. So, for instance, mature Christians should be able to apply the gospel to the brokenness of each other's lives. Do gospel, kind of basic level gospel shepherding, okay? If you have people coming to you going, hey, I need to meet with you, my marriage isn't doing well, we're not going to do that too long because we need to get some other people in their life who can walk with them longer than you'll be able to. So what I told some of our leaders is do a few of those visits, but bring someone else in with you so they can learn how to do it like you're doing it, so you can eventually hand more of that training off to more people. So don't do ministry alone, do it with others and train them how to do it without you eventually. At Soma, whenever I had a very young church when we first started, still pretty young, but we had a lot of people who were in significant financial problems. They didn't know how to budget their life at all, certainly didn't know how to budget their finances. And so what I told our group leaders, I said, I want you to be able to help everybody build a budget that reflects the gospel and how they build it. And I remember one guy came to me and said, man, you have no idea, Jeff. I've got a family that is so deeply entrenched in debt. I don't have a clue how to help them. And I said, well, how about if I and you meet with them to help them figure out how the gospel applies to this stuff, and we'll help them get out of it, and then you will learn how to do it with others, and then eventually you won't need me to do it. Are you willing to do that? So he did. I never got asked by him again to ever do that one more time because we did it the first time. He knew he was getting trained to do it without me after that, and so he could do it without me. So it's those kinds of things that you start building in. It's the type of thing where we pray with people after our gatherings, but we also encourage people when they go to communion, and we have communion every single Sunday. They come together, they get around a table. Me or someone else sets it up, in a sense, defends the table, makes sure people know, like, this is for those who express faith in Jesus, this is what it means. But we want to encourage you to go together with your family. Parents, feel free to go get your kids, bring them in if they have faith. We'd love for them to join you in this. If you're a missional community, feel free to do that together. If with your friends, do it together. And there's tables all over the room, and they come to the table, dip the bread in the cup, and then go together, and they get into a little circle, and I encourage them to pray together. And I say, you know, one of you might want to lead in light of my message in the gospel, maybe say something like this. So I teach them to say the gospel around the elements to each other and then pray to each other, pray with each other. And at first, when I said I was going to introduce it at Doxa, I was walking into an incredibly introverted church. If you guys can imagine Bellevue, Washington, you know, my backyard is Microsoft. So, you know, engineers, you know, Boeing engineers, all kinds of IT people. So everyone's like, Jeff, no, they like going in by themselves, sitting by themselves, going to the communion table by themselves, going back to their chair by themselves and leaving by themselves. They're going to hate this. And I said, nobody is good alone. So I don't care. I know God wants us to be in community, and I think they'll like it. They're just going to have to try it. I said, let me try it 4 weeks in a row, see how it goes. So we open up space in the room so people would have room to gather and pray together. That's a paradigmatic shift, because what you're saying at that moment is we're okay with fewer people in the room versus having more chairs. Because I know how the chair thing works. 75% full, it feels too full, no one invites their friends. I know all the stats, but at this point I care less about more numbers and more about building a DNA into our people that when we get more numbers they can minister to. So I'm okay slowing down for a bit. So we make space. The first week we do it. People get together, a little awkward, you can tell, but they do it. All I heard that week was, that was the most amazing thing. Can we do that every week? I said, yeah, I was planning on it. Let's keep going. And now what's really encouraging is, even though we have people trained to pray with people after each gathering, a lot of times we don't even have to have people ready for each gathering because they're praying with each other in groups. Because we trained our people how to start doing ministry together in the gathering. That's a paradigm shift. When I start seeing the gathering not as, come let me minister to you, but rather, let me equip you so you can learn how to minister to others, that changes how I do everything then on Sunday, okay? Another thing that just as a kind of a shift that we got into is, you've got to realize, and this is another point to write down, you've got to pay attention to what you celebrate publicly. Okay? Because whatever you celebrate is what they believe you value. Okay, that's always the case. So if you're like, man, this is awesome. We went from like 100 to 300 in the last 4 years. They think success was more people in the building. Now, it's not bad to be excited about that. That's not a bad thing necessarily. But what else do you celebrate? You know, you celebrate baptisms. That's a good thing to celebrate if you baptize. But do you only celebrate you getting to baptize? You know, when I read the Great Commission, it says, make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teach them to do what I taught you. Teach them all that I've commanded you. So that means your disciples need to baptize people. So do you celebrate your disciples baptizing people? Like, for instance, I had Victor, really huge guy, looks like The Rock. Some of you know who The Rock is. He got baptized last year at Easter. Came out of the water. Water's everywhere, you know. It's like, in fact, it's, we caught it on video. It's just so powerful, you know. And when he got out of the water and he got up out of the tank, and I was right there with a towel and some other people baptized him, not me, and I gave him a big hug, and I looked like a super small little guy next to him, which is already hilarious. But I said, Victor, I want to remind you, you just got commissioned to be a disciple maker of Jesus Christ. And so I'm expecting you to be in the water in the future with somebody that you lead to Christ and you help take the obedient step of getting baptized. He told me later, he said, Jeff, when you said that, it's like the Spirit fell on me. And he said, it was so powerful. And he said, I actually believed I was now supposed to be a minister of the gospel. He said, where do I go to seminary? I said, you don't need to. I said, you can if you want, and we've got classes here, and we actually host them at our building, so you're welcome to do that, but you get to go be a disciple maker now because you have the Spirit of God on you. You have what you need. And so I say that because our church is seeing us more and more. In fact, we just did baptism a few weeks ago again, and there was a husband and wife in the tank baptizing a member of their missional community, because I said I would love to see more missional communities baptizing their members. And so this woman responded in faith, in repentance, got baptized. Later, because this couple are friends of mine, I said, what was that like? How'd you feel about that? And she said, it was amazing. I've never baptized anybody in my entire life because I wasn't allowed to. She said, it's like, man, I want to get back in there. I want to see more people come to Jesus. And see, here's the deal. We get excited about it, those who get to have the position of, you know, like, for lack of a better word, clergy, though I'd hate that, to be honest. But we like get to feel the joy of some of those amazing moments. What if every church member got to experience that? The joy of the Lord as they see themselves participating with his work of establishing someone in their faith. So celebrate. Another thing we did during our First Peter series, we had a missional community up on the stage every single week. Now, you guys are going like, how did you get to missional communities in 4 months? All I did is I took what were community groups, which, just so you know, for Mars Hill, they were basically sermon discussion groups. So you would discuss the sermon from Sunday. You were kind of a care group with Christians primarily. There wasn't an outworking of mission generally. There were a few unique ones because their groups just did it, but that wasn't the expectation. And so I came in and said, we're just gonna start calling you missional communities, even though I know you're not acting like one, but I believe the imperatives, the indicatives lead to the imperatives. So God said, you're righteous, but I know my life. I don't live very righteous, but he still says I'm righteous, so I wanna live out my identity. I'm saying you're a missional community, which means you're a family of servant missionaries sent as disciples who make disciples. I didn't make that up. The Bible says you're the family of God, so love one another like you are. The Bible says you're servants of Jesus, so now extend his kingdom into the world through tangible service. The Bible says you're missionaries, ambassadors, sent by God to be his witnesses. It's what you are, so I'm not making that up. That's who you are. A missional community for us is you living that out together with some people. So I just said, I'm gonna call you that, even though I know you're not living like that, and I'll give you 3 to 5 years to figure out how to live like that. So I gave a lot of time, just so you know. By the way, if you lead a church in transition, don't expect immediate change. It takes, from my experience, at least 3 years for people to get this. 1 year to undo their paradigm, a second year to build up a new one, and a third to practice that new paradigm. We're told that it takes about 10,000 hours to develop a practice that's really good. Jesus spent 3.5 years with his disciples. So I think it's okay to give your church lots of time, patient, gracious. I kept telling our church, which was a high performance culture, partly because it's the east side of Seattle, but partly because that's part of the culture that they built. I kept saying failure is the new success at Doxa. So if you step out to try to be on mission and you fail, we're gonna applaud that. So the stories that we had on stage every week during our first Peter Church Everywhere series, a lot of them were missional communities saying, we don't have a mission. We're not even clear who we're supposed to reach. To be honest, we're not even a very healthy family. And you go like, and I go, all right, cool. This is a grace culture. Let's celebrate that. Well, how can we pray for you? Will you pray that God would show us a mission? Would you pray that we'd learn how to love each other better? I said, great. Everybody raise your hands. If you want to lay hands on them from where you're seated and kind of just bless their work in prayer, just raise your hands. And then I'd walk over and put my hands on them. And the whole congregation prayed over them. And we prayed over those things. And then we get done and say, let's give them like our thanks for taking a risk. They're stepping out. This is awesome. So what am I doing? I'm celebrating not like everybody that's amazing at discipleship making. I'm celebrating anybody who will step out in faith to just try, right? So we just did that week after week after week. And I had people come to me going like, so it's okay like for us not to get it? Yeah, it is. You're not gonna get it. It's okay. But you're only gonna get it if you step out and start to try. So that's a whole church shift. And it should affect your finances. I asked my finance guy, I said, I want you to do an audit on how much it costs to run Sunday. And I said, not just Sunday, the cost of the day, but the man hours of every volunteer. And then I want you to take every paid staff member and tell me how many hours did we spend during the week preparing for Sunday, message prep, meetings that we talked through, evaluation, and I want you to take how much they cost an hour, and I want you to add up how much Sunday costs for us on a yearly basis. When he came back with that number, he goes, this is absolutely embarrassing. We spend way too much money on something that does so little good. And he said, it's not that it's bad, it's just that proportionately, we should be putting more energy into leadership development and training and coaching and getting with our people and training them to be on the mission. And if we could do that, we'd have way more effectiveness than what Sunday can produce. Sunday can do something, it's good. It's just limited. Please know that. I hope you know that. That's probably why you're here. So I trust that. So even financially, where's our money going? And then think through, like, how many meetings do you spend on things that maybe you should shift your energies away from? Those are all important things to think through. And I'll get to doing that audit a little bit more further down our talk. But any questions so far? I just gave you a whole bunch of stuff. No one's raised their hand, so that's fine. Okay, there we go. Yes. We don't have a Sunday school system. Yeah. We basically have, I call our church to four things, and you're gonna laugh because I call them 4 G's. So there were 5 G's at Willow, I got 4 G's. But this is basically what we do. We gather, go, give, grow. Okay, the gatherer is coming together on a Sunday or some other form for equipping. And we say our gatherings exist to equip the saints for works of ministry, to encourage the saints, well, because they're on ministry, and hopefully to exhort them to the person of Jesus, who is really our hope for ministry. So encourage, equip, exhort. Okay. Go is they're on a mission together in a missional community. Give is they're using their spiritual gifts and finances to support the work. And then grow is a DNA group for us. Basically, it's three men or three women or more. We're not legalistic about this, but they get together weekly generally to study God's word together, to grow in a particular skill. So like if they needed to know like what Sunday school might say, we're going to teach you in spiritual warfare. Well, like my missional community has our ladies on Monday nights going through training on spiritual warfare right now. Me and the guys get together Monday morning for DNA group. We're going through the book of Mark right now. But that's partly because that's what I'm preaching through, and I just said I want to go through the same thing I'm preaching. It makes it easier for me. So we don't have anything else. These are all the programs we have as a church, and then we ask people to figure out how to fit what they need into one of these three categories, really. Because give isn't a program. That's just a heart posture. Yeah. We expect that to happen in a missional community. Yeah. So all of our missional communities are coached by elders or trained quality theologians. I mean, they know their stuff, you know. And they basically are taking them through a curriculum if they haven't been through it yet for their training, or they're helping them with what they should have already learned. Yep. And then we expect what would normally happen by the church to happen by the missional community. So the majority of things that you normally do at church, counseling, care, instruction, you name it, that happens in the missional community, which forces us to have to train the missional community. Now, I want to let you know, I'm only 1 year in, so I can't say that we're doing this incredibly. But that's the long-term goal, is to keep moving towards that. At SOMA in Tacoma, we did do that. So we could push everybody. You could get pre-engagement counseling through your missional community. You get budget counseling through your missional community. The things that you need, you go to your missional community first. And if for some reason that missional community wasn't equipped in that, then it was the job of the elder that oversaw that missional community to get them equipped so in the future they could. And then we actually had to license missional community leaders to do weddings. Because you get to the place where they did all the pre-engagement counseling, and the person's like, well, I want them to do my wedding because they're really like my pastor anyway. Can't they do it? And then we would license them for that wedding in that month, and it would be a temporary license that we would give for the state of Washington to legitimize the thing. So we started, it was fun because it created categories we never thought we had to think through, you know? And we saw more people doing funerals and weddings, and you know, we started seeing more baby dedications happening there versus in the larger gathering, and everything just started going to that place of church, the more we treated it like they could be the church. Yeah, the hand back there, and then you. Do we share testimonies when, like, people, like, I got to share with my coworker and stuff? Yeah, a lot of that happens inside of the missional community, and then we also, we've made it a point every Sunday now a story is going to be told, and we're now changing it not so every week's a missional community story. We're doing at least one missional community story a month. We're doing one church planting story or international kind of story that we're working on around the world. We're doing a financial update because I came into a situation where there wasn't a lot of financial transparency. So the third Sunday, every Sunday is a financial update. That one actually combines with our church planting report or highlight around the world. And then we do a personal story of someone like who shared their faith or came to faith or had a huge breakthrough. And then we've got servant stories. So those are people that we're highlighting their great servants in our church come up, and we want to highlight them in front of people so that we keep showing their giving. So basically these four things, gather, go, give, grow, we highlight them through stories. That's what we're doing. So because what you celebrate is what you are also probably measuring, and what your church sees you measure and celebrate, they believe is the most important thing. And that's where they'll give their time, or they'll find another church. And that's just the way they work. So, yes, over here. Okay, so the question is, do Sunday school and missional communities compete, or can they coexist? I think everything is connected to your culture and how busy your people are and how much space they've got to do more. And so, like, we have training going on. We have a 9 o'clock and 11 o'clock service right now at Docks. I'm sure there may be more added, but that's where we're at today, which I like. I prefer never adding anymore. That's all I really want. But So what that does, though, is it allows people during one of the services to get training. So I told all my staff, you don't have to be in both services. Feel free to use one of those gathering times to train people, to do equipping, to do counseling, to do whatever. Use it. It's there. Their kids are probably being cared for. In fact, if they can only come to one gathering and you need to meet with them, I'm okay with them not coming to hear me preach, because they can watch that on video if they want. Like, so it's up later during the week. So I said the highest priority is equipping our people for works of ministry, not getting them to hear me preach. I'm one of the tools of our church. So if they don't need me, then that's fine. Let's get them to something else. One of the greatest compliments I had from a young man years ago at SOMA is he said, you know what, I don't know that I need to come hear you preach anymore. I feel like we could go do this and start our own church. He said, I don't want to offend you. I mean, I like your preaching. I said, that's not offensive at all. That's the goal. That's what I'm after. If I don't ever get people here that are growing up and starting their own families, then I'm like the parents who don't know how to raise their kids, and they got 45-year-old men still sucking off mama's, you know what, and getting their pants changed, you know? Like, sorry, this is the South, right? I can't get away with that. Maybe not. It is Austin. Come on now, people. Anyway, my goal is that my daughter will be walked down the aisle one day if God wants her to be married, or will be released on her own as an adult woman, either way, either in marriage or not, but she will be able to be an adult woman who can lead her life and help others be affected in powerful ways, just like we affected hers. And to me, that's the goal of the church, is we raise people up so they don't need us forever. And that's the sign of success. So, but back to your question, I would say if you have Sunday school, use it intentionally to equip. You know? So don't throw away things that you could repurpose. If they're used to going at saying, hey, from now on, we're going to offer this class, and by the way, most of your church won't say yes to this right away. There's pioneers and early adopters that will. Get them in the training, give them the very best of your leadership. Okay, when they start seeing, man, I've got the phone number, I've got the access to the office, anytime I need help, they're there to help me. They're going to know that this is a priority now in your church. Versus what usually gets the priority is the people who don't ever want to do anything in your church but want to take up your time, right? So you start using Sunday school class to train up mission, but then you get practice that they have to engage in. That's the key. Most of our training is primarily cognitive, very little experience-based. And part of it's because of the Western way of education is very broken. The United States is broken in our education. We don't teach people how to do much. We don't teach them how to think. We just teach them how to regurgitate facts and information we gave them. And so we keep doing the same thing in the church. And that's why people need to keep coming to you to get what they need, because you're the answer person. So you got to train them for obedience. So let me give you an illustration of how to do that, and I'll come to your hand. I see that. If you're in Sunday school class or you're in a Bible study, shift from just learning to, okay, if we actually understood this and believe this, what would we do with it together first? How would we obey in community this week? So we're going to obey in community what we just learned with each other. And then how would we obey in community on mission? Because the Bible was not written primarily for individual application. It just wasn't. It was written for communal application. The majority of the Bible is written to a people, not to a person. And even when it's written to a person, it's about how that person should lead the people. You know, Timothy, Titus, Philemon, others. So it's always meant for communal obedience, communal application. We have made the Bible a tool for personal piety and personal application, not communal obedience. But God has called us to be a people, not an individual in isolation. So call them to obey it together, call them to obey it on mission. That's the second part of the Bible. The Bible is not only written to people, plural, but it was written as God's tool for the mission. Christopher Wright says it this way. I love how he says it. The Bible doesn't have a mission. The mission has a Bible. The mission preceded the Bible. The mission of God was happening way before a Bible was given to us, because it was at the beginning of, before time. You know, in eternity past, the mission started in God's mind. So the mission preceded the Bible. The Bible is given to us so we know the missionary heart of God. We know how to join him in his work in this world. Same with the church. The church doesn't have a mission. The mission has a church. The church exists because of the mission of God, not the other way around. So we are here because God's on mission in the world. So, okay, there was a hand back there. Yeah, right there. Yes, that's, I'm going to say it. So as we focus on caring for one another, how does that not fight against the mission of reaching out to those who are outside of us? And what I would say is they have to coexist. So let me give you a picture here of what this looks like. Most often what we say is that we've got mission and we've got community, and they're at odds with each other. So we swing the pendulum one way or the other. But the Bible doesn't know those two words separated. Okay? Now let me explain this. Jesus says in John 17, I pray that you would make them one so that the world would know that you sent me. And I pray that you would not take them out of the world but leave them in the world. What is he saying? He's saying if you go on mission but you don't have a community, you don't have the apologetic that the gospel actually worked. Your love for one another in the middle of a broken world is evidence that God showed up and changed everything around here. Like, that's your apologetic that the gospel really works. So you can't go on mission without community, because what you get is you get an isolated evangelist who cannot show the power of the gospel at work. And that's why so many people go out all by themselves and come back very frustrated going, I can't do evangelism. Well, you weren't meant to do it alone. Jesus sent him out in pairs. Paul went as a team. His worst time in mission was in Athens when he's all by himself and he had almost no fruit. That's the Apostle Paul. So he needed a team around him, because it's the team that gives the evidence that the gospel is an active reality, not only a past event, that God is still at work saving amongst us as he's changing us. So that's the one side. The other side is people go, you know, I can do mission without, I'm sorry, I can do community without mission. The problem is if you have community without mission, try to do mission without community, you're isolated, you lose the apologetic. Try to do community without mission, you become focused on yourselves, and it's a codependent group, and it will eventually just feed on itself and it will die. And you guys know you've been in those groups. Like, you're trying to figure out, which curriculum should we pick next? Because this group stinks. Nobody really wants to be here. It's not really, there's no reason for existing. Why are we doing this? Because our church said we had to meet together. Why? And nobody has an answer, because we're supposed to love one another. Yeah, but you're supposed to love one another on mission. How many of you guys have ever been on a mission trip? In fact, I answered this earlier to somebody. They said, like, won't we, like, lose that sense of love for one another if we're on mission all the time? Not if you're on mission together. Because if you've been on a mission trip together, you come back, you love each other more. Whenever you give yourself, anybody who's been on a sports team knows what kind of community got formed when you were fighting together to win. Like, there's nothing like that. And that's what God intends for his people, is to form that kind of deep level love for one another while they're giving their lives away to other people. So you got to have them both. And they live in tension in some ways, because our flesh wants them to live in tension. But in the Godhead, they don't live in tension at all. Because God is perfect community, always on mission at the same time. And that's a healthy group, by the way, when you have both going on at the same time. Any other questions? I'll keep going through my work here, but this is helpful. How many people do we optimally have in a missional community? I like to start them with about 8 adults and their kids. So sometimes that's like 16, 20, you know. If you live in a homeschool community, that's 100, but... just kidding, I had to throw that in there. 8 adults, you know, that's 4 families. If they all, I guess that'd be more like if you're the Duggars, you know, so close to 100. But I like to start that way because I want them to feel room to reach people. And a lot of times groups start so big they don't have any room for anybody else. And that's why we have the tension, because we're like, I'm trying to love 20-some people and you're telling me to go reach these people. It's like, no. We might need to make them a little smaller so we can love each other really well and then go reach people that don't know Jesus yet. And we have capacity for that kind of relational sphere to build, okay? So I don't like them to get much bigger than 30, because they will grow. And then hopefully you're constantly kind of tapping some of the shoulders saying, I think God might be calling you. You've been expressing desire to reach your neighbors or these friends at work, or it seems like you desire to lead something. Could we help you learn how to lead something here? And then we could send you out to start one. So, all right, I'll keep going. Oh, yes, sir. How do you find and qualify a person to lead a missional community? Ideally through a missional community. Ideally, they're in one, people know them, watch them, observe them. They've gotten a chance to lead more and more in that missional community. People follow their lead. I had one missional community. I sent 3 missional communities out of at one time. And leading up to that, I said, hey, these three have all expressed interest, these three groups of leaders, of going out and starting a new missional community. I'm okay if you all leave. It won't offend me. That's what I'm here for, is to send out. So don't feel bad, but you don't have to go with them either. So you can make a choice. So the next month, they're going to try and recruit you to join them on their mission. And I'm perfectly fine with that, but you can make the call. And then at the end of that, I said, I let them know, we'll have that fifth week will be the decision-making week, and we'll have a time where we pray and say, okay, Nick and Becky, you go over there, and John and Heidi, you go over there, and who was the other one? I'm forgetting. Go over there. And I put them in different parts of the room, and I said, if you want to join them on the mission, go join them right now. And they're going to lead you through now how you're going to take steps to leave the group. And then next week, we're going to have a grieving party where we celebrate the success of what God's doing here, and we cry together because it's going to be a loss. And we need to take time to mourn that because it's real, and it's hard, but it's good, and we're not moving to another city. We can still see each other. So that's what we did. If nobody would have followed those three, then I would have told them they're not ready yet. Right? Because leaders are distinguished by followership. You know, just because you lead all by yourself doesn't mean you're leading. Okay? You're just taking a walk alone, right? So there's got to be people behind you. Okay? So hopefully they've got leadership, they've got character, they've got influence, they've built credibility, they have something worth following, all that. And we'll talk more about that in our weekend training that I'm going to do. But does that help a little bit? Yeah, good. Yes, Molly. Oh, yeah. So our Docs is doing a missional community pilot group. So we realized, and this is maybe another way to answer your question, we realized there's a lot of people who are trying to get in a group. Nothing's working for them because of their schedules or because of the geography. You know, we're a regional church where I'm at, so we're drawing from a very large distance to come to our gathering on Sunday. So we said, we're going to take the 11 o'clock gathering time, and we're going to take them through 12 weeks of missional community training. They watch a video during the week, and then they'll get a coaching cohort where they process through what they learned that week and how they're going to apply it with some people the following week. And they're going to get 12 weeks of that. That'll allow us to see leaders rise up and hopefully get trained pretty well. It'll also help us to form new groups. We already know of 7 groups that are probably going to get started because we have 7 groups or leaders that want to start groups. And then we have others who are not in a group at all. My guess, some of them will join those 7 leaders. And some of them might say, I want to be a leader. I didn't know I could. So that's the pilot group. We're going to do that once a quarter. And we're doing it during our Sunday gathering so their kids can be cared for and go while I'm preaching on the stage. We're also offering one on Wednesday night too, but most people are taking the Sunday morning because the Wednesday night doesn't provide childcare. And where I'm at, that's a big winner. So, by the way, side note, when I said pay equippers and administers, if you want to equip your people for works of ministry, pay attention to all the reasons why they don't get equipped. So I'm just going to give you a couple for me. When I told our men and women in our church, you are both image bearers, both called to the ministry. I'm a complementarian, and the way I describe that is, I said that for that me, that means I believe you have to have a man and a woman for marriage, and you have to have men and women for ministry. You can't have a healthy church if you only have men ministering. You can't have a healthy church if you only have women ministering. You have a healthy church because you have men and women in ministry. So I'm going to commit to equip men and women here. And I had so many women come up in tears, like, man, I'm just so thankful that you value me. I'm single. I haven't gotten married. I couldn't have kids. I felt like if I wouldn't get married and couldn't have kids, I wasn't valued at this church. I'm like, well, that's not this church anymore. So this is a different church. We value like crazy. I'm not saying that Mars Hill didn't, but that's the message she got. And a lot of women, single women, got in particular, because I think the marriage card was beat pretty strongly, which is great. I love marriage, love kids. But they didn't hear it. And by the way, this is the good thing about coming in as the objective guy, because I know when people took over my church in Tacoma, they talked about the stuff that I didn't do well as well. So I get it. You know, we all are weak and we all screw up. And I've got plenty of mistakes I've made. But this was one that stood out. So then we said, we've got to do everything we can to equip women. So we'd say, hey, this equipping, this training is for men and women. Please come. And the guys would show up, and I'd go, hey, where's your wife? Oh, someone had to stay home with the kids. And I said, that's you. You stay home with the kids so she can come and get trained. And he's like, what? I'm like, yeah, that's how we do things around here from now on. You lay down your life for her so she can be served by you, so she can get equipped and trained. We value your wife really a whole lot. I know you do, but maybe you didn't know you could do that. So that's going to be okay for you not to get trained for a while so she can. Well, then we realized they still didn't do it because For some reason, it's just easier. Moms would go, it's just so much easier for me to stay home. You know, I got a routine and you go. So then we said, we've got to provide childcare, otherwise they won't make it. So that's what we've been starting to do so that we can make it easier for them to get equipped. If you want to value, in my case, men and women ministry, it means I have men and women on the stage pretty much every week in some facet, helping to lead worship, sharing a story, giving announcements, co-teaching with me, something. But we're going to value men and women so that they keep seeing it. Because if you're going to say every member's a ministry, you better actually put your money where your mouth is and actually show that you believe it. So you got to really celebrate that. So that's how we did it. I'll keep going if I can. You good? Yeah, yep, good. I don't even know what number I'm on because I jumped around. So I'm just going to give you, here's another bullet point that you need to get. Leadership must be aligned. Okay, you might be going like, I'm the youth pastor, I'm going to lead our church this direction. No, you're not. Now, if you have authority over your youth ministry, lead your youth ministry that direction. That's the authority God's given you. You might go, I'm the senior pastor or lead pastor, I'm going to lead my church this direction. Not if you're an elder-led church, you better get your team on the same page. And if you try to lead your church in a direction that your team isn't going with you on, you'll divide your church. So leadership alignment is absolutely core, especially at the theological conviction. They've got to be able to all say with one heart, as we've sought the word, as we've struggled through this, we believe together this is what God's called us to do because this is what he's done to make us who we are today. So that should be, I shouldn't have to say that, but I can tell you there's too many divided churches because they didn't get united before they made a shift, okay? Fourth or sixth or whatever it is at this point, begin with repentance. What I mean by that is if you're going to transition your church from what it was to something else, please know that that is repentance, okay? When something changes in your life, it's because you had a change of mind about something, okay? That's how it works. Repentance produces a change of life. At the heart of repentance is a change of your God, a change of your view of God. And when you have a new change of what God's like, it leads to a new behavior in your life. So you've got to publicly repent. And I don't mean like grovel and, you know, beat yourself up. I'm just saying be willing to say in front of the church, you know what, we're still learning. I know we've been around for 125 years. Praise God, we're still learning. Isn't that a good thing? This is a grace-filled church where we get to keep falling, keep learning, keep growing. We hope that we never stop learning until Jesus returns, which means we're going to repent a lot from this stage. And when you do that, you also give all your people the freedom to join you in repentance. In other words, they can go, man, I really loved what we used to have, but I can see that there's some things we need to rethink, and man, I need to repent too. And all of a sudden you create a culture of repentance, you'll create a culture that's willing to change. But when you don't create a culture of repentance, you won't create a culture that's willing to change, which means they will resist the change you're leading them to because there's no repentance preceding it. So there's gotta be repentance at the heart of this change. And by the way, let me just clarify what the gift of repentance is. Repentance comes about when God illuminates your heart on a new truth about him, which means you grew in sanctification. And repentance is your confidence that the gospel is sufficient, not just for your justification, but your ongoing sanctification. So like, it's a great proclamation to repent. It actually affirms to your church the gospel's good and sufficient for all of us. I was speaking in Australia at a Bible school, and me and Tim Chester were doing this a few years back. I love Tim Chester. You should read his stuff. We got done, and we had a little Q&A time, and the president of the Bible college raised his hand, and he said, I think I agree with all that you've been saying. And tears started to stream down his eyes. I'm like, I don't know what's going on. He is deeply affected. And I don't know if it was joy. It looked like sorrow. And he went on to say, I'm convinced you've made a biblical case for these things, and I think you're right. He said, and what that means is I've wasted my whole life because I haven't been teaching any of this. And in that moment, the Spirit of God reminded me that the only reason we can be where we're at is because we're standing on the shoulders of those who've gone ahead of us. And so I just said, no way. Not true for a minute. I couldn't have opened the Word of God with the kind of authority and confidence and courage in this place had you not held up the Word of God for all these years. So you've just prepared the way for this next thing to happen. So I want to honor your work. And I say that because I want to encourage you guys, repentance doesn't disparage the past. It honors what God did to lead you to repentance. It honors how you got to the present. So let me encourage you to honor the past, to realize we wouldn't be here were it not for those who preceded us and gave their lives and their energies for the gospel in the way they did. So repentance is based in humility, and humility, it knows honor. It knows how to honor people. So make sure you do that. Also, please, please get a definition of disciple and discipleship. If you're going to lead your people out on mission and they don't know what a disciple is, they won't know what they're doing and what discipleship is. And some of you might be going, well, what's your definition? So I'll give you mine. I go to Matthew 4:19, where Jesus says, follow me, I will make you fishers of men. Okay, I'm not going to write all the words in there, but follow me, make you fishers of men. And then you go to the end, Matthew 28, it says that the disciples, those are the ones who followed him, show up at the mountain where Jesus directed them to go, and there they worshiped him. So we know that to follow Jesus means you're gonna worship Jesus. So worship, let me just clean that up. I'm learning. It's not working. Sorry. We'll just say that's worship Jesus. You can see that? And then he says, I'll make you. And then we know he baptized them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That's a new identity. So obviously there's a change of identity. So they worship Jesus. They're changed by Jesus. And he says, I'll make you fishers of men so that you teach them to obey Jesus. And then they do the same with others. So disciple is one who worships Jesus, is changed by Jesus, and obeys Jesus, and then teaches others to do the same. So that's how I define disciple. If you don't have a definition of disciple, it's like saying we make cars, but all we have is an assembly line. We have no idea what they look like, what they should do. You know, we don't know how to define a car, but we sure are busy doing things. So have a definition of what you mean by disciple, because that's going to shape what you do with your disciples, okay? And then for me, discipleship, I won't write this out, I'll just say it, is leading people to increasingly submit all of life to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. It's leading people to increasingly submit all of life to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. It's not, I've got a good set of theological facts and framework that I live by. It's all of my life increasingly being submitted to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. So it's leading people to do that, okay? So get a definition of disciple, clarify what you think discipleship is. Now you can see, if you believe discipleship is teaching them spiritual disciplines and getting them to affirm your doctrine and be baptized, then you can do it all on Sunday. So don't change anything. But if you believe a disciple is somebody who their marriage reflects submission to Christ, their parenting reflects submission to Christ, their going to work reflects submission to Christ, the way they spend their money reflects submission to Christ, sexuality reflects submission to Christ, everything is meant to be brought under the Lordship of Jesus Christ, then you got to do a whole lot more than Sunday, because you can't do that kind of discipleship in a classroom or on an event. You got to get in their life and help them, or someone's got to get in their life and help them. So that changes how you think of the church. So how you define it will determine what you do, all right? A few other things, and I'll open up some more questions. We've just got a little bit of time. I already said this, but I want to say it again. Change your language where necessary. Redefine it if necessary. Change your language where necessary. Redefine it if necessary. So one of the changes of language for me is we don't go to church. We are the church. That's a very significant statement. There are many who don't agree with me. Some of you may be even in the room, and that's, we can talk later if you want, but the word church literally means gathering, and that's why most people have landed on, that's why church is a gathering, because it's what the word means. Ekklesia is the gathered, to gather, okay? But biblically, and whenever you do your Greek word studies or any other language study, you don't just do your language study in isolation of the text. You do it in the text. And biblically, the text tells us that we are gathered to Jesus Christ. And the text tells us the gathered ones gathered. So the gathering gathered. It uses it in both ways. So it's like we are the church who also churches. right? So that's why it's confusing to people, is because they know the word literally means church, but it also means God's people gathered to Jesus Christ. And so we are the church when we're not gathered, and we are the church gathered, okay? I just have learned to say we don't go to it, because you can't go to yourself, right? I don't go to something I'm not. I gather with what I am. I gather with the church on Sunday, and others do it other days, but that's the day we do it. So I also gather with them on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, and a lot of different ways. We gather together in lots of forms. And the more we gather together on mission, the more the church fills every place. But if we only gather once a week, it only fills a building instead of fills a city. When the people don't know they're the church, they won't think like the church. But when they know they're the church, they'll fill the city with the presence of Christ as they continue to walk in mindfulness of his presence in their life. So, okay, so work on your language. There's a lot of different language you might want to think through. I can't give you all the examples, but there's a lot of language you probably should have someone audit you on. Have a non-Christian come in and tell you what they hear. That's one thing to do. Like I have this, she's now a Christian, but for the first few months of Doxa's existence, she came up to me one time just kind of in fear and said, hey, I want to let you know, like, this didn't make sense. And I said, I'm glad you had the courage to talk to me. Will you tell me every week what doesn't make sense? And I knew a lot of it didn't make sense because she didn't have the Spirit of God, so I couldn't expect her to get the gospel. But when she said, you know, Jeff, you said these are your elders, and you're up there, and you're not old. I don't get it. What's an elder? Is it not an old person? And then I'd explain, I should probably explain what an elder is, you know? And then there was probably another 20 of those kinds of examples where she's like, that didn't make any sense. Could you tell me? So have somebody give you a feedback loop of what they're hearing, especially new people who come from other churches, because they're going to be able to critique you better than those who've been in your soup for far too long. So pay attention to your language. Lastly, and then I'm going to open up for lots of questions if you want it. You've got to determine the method and timing of your transition carefully. Method and timing, okay? Method meaning don't take out a heart of a human and expect the human to keep living. Okay, so whatever's the heart of your organism, you don't get rid of it. So if you're like, Sunday is like the heart, it pumps the blood through the system. It's where we communicate, it's where we preach, it's where we remind them of our vision, it's where the majority of the people get together. I've watched people like just get rid of Sunday and think it's gonna make it. It's probably not gonna make it. There may be a day when Sunday isn't nearly as important as it used to be, but you're gonna have to have another heart pumping blood through the system. And most of our churches, Sunday is that for us. So please, don't be foolish and get rid of the heart. Second, and this is all gonna be like body imagery right now. Second, get rid of anything that's like a bleeding or a poisonous appendix. And I'm just gonna tell you, some of the hardest part about transition is that you gotta get rid of sacred cows. And by very nature of something called a sacred cow, you already know it's idolatrous, right? So anything that people love more than Jesus in your church probably is a problem. And at some point either needs to be repented of, or sometimes they're poisonous and needs to be removed, okay? I'll give you an example. I'm not against Awana, so I'm not gonna try and throw it down if you guys like it, but I was in a church where one of the kids in our church went to Awana at another church. And he said, and he's in high school, he's like, we need to have high school Awana. I'm like, we don't have the staff to like add one more program to this church. This is before I planted a few years back. And so I said, we just can't do it. And they said, well, you just don't believe in discipleship. And I said, that's not true at all. And so we went head to head. We had a family meeting. I mean, it was like this kid and his parents against me. It was a really tough time. And at one point, I realized, like, this is not anything. This has nothing to do about love for Jesus or love for the lost or love for disciple making. This is where he got his badges. And he knew that if we didn't keep doing it, he was going to lose more badges in his high school years, which for him was a big stamp of approval. It had been a false gospel to this kid. And I also knew, like, we could send you to the other church. It's fine. Go to the other church. Not leave our church. Just go to Awana down the street. It's fine. But they really had a lot of pride in wanting it in our church. And it had become poisonous to the point at which there was gossip and slander around the church against anybody who didn't agree with this. And so at one point, I just stopped and I said, I'm going to be really clear. You are not going to win on this. We are not going to do Awana. And the young man said, I'm a better disciple than anybody in this church because of Awana. So I just stopped and said, okay, if that's where we're gonna go, I don't really wanna do this, but tell me about your lost friends that don't know Jesus. And he looked at me, he's like, what? I said, do you have anybody who doesn't know Jesus that would call you their friend? He goes, no. I said, tell me any person you led to Christ. Well, I don't have any. Tell me anybody you're helping follow Christ. Nobody. I said, well, what are you talking about? You're better at discipleship. He goes, I know more of the Bible than anybody else here. I said, and you're a Pharisee. Because you don't love Jesus and you don't love the lost and you don't love people. You are using the word of God to discard people right now. And this is a high school kid. He started weeping right in front of everybody. I'm like, brother, I love you. I want to be with you. I want to pray for you. I came over and put my arm around him. And his family stayed in the church and we made it through. But I needed to fight that battle because I'm not against Awana. I was against the poisonous nature in which they wanted a program to take place because it represented something more to them than Jesus Christ. And there are those in your church that are in that place and it's enslaving them. And God didn't come around, you know, the calf, golden calf with Aaron and tell Moses, hey, just join them in the dance. He told them to grind the thing up and drink it. Like, he was not happy with their idolatry. And he told them to get rid of it. And so there are times when we'll have to do that. There will be poisonous things in your church and you just have to say sorry. Now, there are other things where there's organs in your church that you know have been sucking the church dry of its energy, but it's not producing any discipleship whatsoever. And what I just do in those situations, I just don't give them any more energy. I don't necessarily remove them. I just don't feed them. And so like we had some ladies come to me and say, hey, we've been doing this one thing for a long time. We'd love to keep doing it. I said, that's fine, but we won't be putting staff toward it. We won't be putting counseling toward it or mentoring toward it or any of that. It's going to have to be your own thing, and you're certainly welcome to do that. We are fine with the body doing lots of ministries on their own, but it won't be an official ministry that Doxa gets behind and supports. It won't get stage time. It won't get staff time. It won't get dollars. And they said, we get it. We know that you have limited. I said, we have limited resources. If I try to keep everything running really well here, everything will be bad. We've got to do a few things and do them really well in this next season until we know we can prove that we're making disciples and make disciples. Until we get to that, we don't get to add a whole lot more. So let's simplify for the sake of strengthening. And they were great with me. They're still part of our church. They're still doing those works. I had one person say, why don't we start MOPS around here? That's so great. Moms love it. I said, we don't need to. There's at least three other churches doing it. And so let's just encourage our families to go there for MOPS. They're fine with us coming as from other churches. Like that's like let's not duplicate what's already happened that's really good in our city. And that'd be another thing I'd encourage you to do. Get rid of duplication. There's a lot of churches doing the same thing. If they started partnering together, we would better organize our resources, be better stewards of our resources, and actually unite the church by saying, let's win together instead of on our own. So I'd encourage you to think through that. So there's a couple of those. That's all body thinking. So don't get rid of the heart. Get rid of poisonous organs. Don't feed ones that are not contributing to the body anymore. And then be slow to do it. So when someone gets surgery on their body, if they have to have lots of things taken out and replaced, you don't do them all at once. You one at a time, very carefully, very methodically, very with a lot of care, a lot of love, a lot of shepherding, so that it doesn't feel like you just like tore your church apart. You can do a lot of damage, and you won't love people at all if you just try to change your church at the expense of your people. Your people are the church. So lead them. Lead them gently. Lead them carefully. Lead them patiently. Be willing for them not to get it for a long time. It's okay. And help the ones that get it quickly. Give them the best of your energy to help them learn how to get it. And that's the next part. I like the yeast method. So when a few are getting it, tell them to gossip it all over the church. There is a good kind of gossip. It's called gospel. Proclaim the gospel. Proclaim the good news of Jesus. Proclaim how he's doing great work in our church. And so I just tell people, tell the stories. Tell people about what you're experiencing. Let people know how great it is to see God at work in your lives. And so that a yeast kind of starts to make itself through the entire dough of your church. And people, it'll be like this. A group will go, hey man, like this one woman came to me. She said, I want to be a part of a missional community that's like actually serious about making disciples. The one I'm in, all we're doing is just like getting together and eating a meal and, you know, we don't do anything. And I told them that, and she's a brand new Christian. She's like, I told them I want to be a disciple. I want to make disciples. This is my life. I gave my life to this. I want to actually live it. And I said, man, you're awesome. Let's have you lead a group in a year or two. But she said, can I join your group? I said, absolutely. If you want to get serious, we're serious and we'll pour into you. And what'll happen, I talk to the group, they know it. What'll happen is they'll go, can you help us get serious? Eventually they're gonna want to not lose people that are excited about Jesus and want to get on his mission. They're going to want to see those people stay. And so we'll help them. by doing that. So that's a yeast method. And then the last one is a wineskin method. And I kind of already said this, but I want to say it in a different way. You might have wineskins that can handle this wine, and you might not. And you've got to determine whether they can. I think most small groups can handle the wineskin or the wine of a missional community approach. I really believe they can. The question is, can your people handle the new wine? That's the different one. But the mechanism of a small group and the way churches order their small groups, most of them could shift to be missional communities by taking what they're learning and applying it together in community on mission during the week. If they just did that, I think they could make the shift. But they'd need a lot of coaching and a lot of mentoring along the way. And if I could say that, please know that when people need to make a shift, it's not like a one-time vision cast Sunday that does it. You need to do it every single Sunday. You need to do it in every single meeting. You need to do it in every single interaction. I mean, it's got to be constant for years that you're not going to give up talking about this with the same language, same terms, having the same meaning over and over and over again. So, and most of you guys know, change comes because people want something different more than they want today. So you got to paint a compelling picture of the future that's better than the one they're experiencing. So if you want them to move forward into something new, you better learn how to paint a picture of what it's going to be like when we love each other really well on mission, when Jesus shows up in powerful ways in the work that he's doing through our lives. Like, you got to start telling the stories. And the way that you get people there is you tell them stories of others who are doing it to encourage them, and you give them a picture of what it'll look like when they do it so they can be encouraged by the future. Okay? It's a lot of content. I've got 15 minutes that we can do Q&A. Some of you might be done and just go, I can't handle anymore, Jeff. I'm out of here. And I won't be offended. Yes. Yeah, so the question is, I said a lot of things run through our missional communities, and I'm talking about Tacoma. I'm getting Doxa there. But Soma, that's how it worked, and that's where I want Doxa to get to. So the question is, do we run everything through your missional communities that happen when they're in that weekly event? And for us, we have to clarify, a missional community is not an event. It's a people. So they've got to figure out when to do that. So like if they're doing pre-marriage counseling, they'd probably set up a separate meeting with that couple to walk through it. Right now at Doxa, I've got one of our elders doing a pre-marriage counseling class that people can go through, and we encourage them to bring someone with them if they can. But we aren't there yet on that one. I will be, hopefully someday. And there's tools, like you could use video training. So you guys go through the video teaching together and then talk about it with a mentor couple from your missional community, and they'll walk you through the process. So we'll get there, but they wouldn't do it necessarily at that once a week meal that they're having. That's probably not the best place to do it. What I usually determine with a group is, what does the group need? If they all need something, then do it together. If a few need it, see who else in the group can teach them it. If no one else in the group can teach them it, we bring people outside in to teach the group. So eventually they can teach each other. So, yes. How do they determine where and how they're going to join God's mission? So it's a variety of ways that we do that. When they start a new group, we usually ask, does this leadership team have an already clarified mission? And I don't want to teach all of my stuff for this weekend, but that's one of the pieces that I'll talk about. You've got to have a clarified mission if you're going to start a new group. If not, we're going to help you walk through a prayerful process of determining where God would have you. And we know that it could change, and that's perfectly fine, but you at least need to have a focus, some kind of clarified mission. If they're a group that already exists and they're trying to find one, we'll probably join them in asking three questions. One, is there any people group that God has put on the heart of anybody in your group? Like, is there anybody that anybody cares for? If not, then you guys probably need to get out and start loving the lost and being in community and pray to God to open your eyes to the harvest. Two, is there an open door for the gospel that God's opened up? So for instance, my neighbor across the street years ago, the missional community met at my house, but our neighbor never came to faith, still hasn't. This is when I was in Tacoma. She loved us. We had so much fun with her and her husband and her kids. She started opening doors into a school for me and my wife. Like she said, you guys, she was like the best evangelist because she would say, I got some people you need to meet. I think they need to hear what you told me about Jesus. You know I don't believe it, but they might. She did that all the time. So like God opened doors for us for the gospel to be brought to another place. And that third one is a person of peace, and she was both of those. So she was a person of peace that got me into a lot of places, and she was opening a lot of doors. So I usually will ask a group, do you have anybody already that the group cares for? Just if not, do you have any open doors that you see in front of you that could be places where God wants you to go? And is there any people of peace that you might just go and say, hey, do you know anything in our city where we could get involved? So like the open door piece, we had a girl, Zach's right here. Zach, you can raise your hand. He can maybe tell you more about it if you want to talk to him. He helps coach missional communities. So he was coaching a missional community to determine their mission. And they realized they have a girl who goes to this alternative school where tons of kids who are very broken and they can't make it through most school systems are at. It's a Christian school made up mostly of non-Christians. And she's like, that's where I go to school and I have a heart for that. And they just made that their mission then. Because here you have a big open door. And they just shared about it this last week at our gathering. It was really encouraging to hear what they're doing. It was cool because it was like a high school student. And how old is Derek, 23? Oh yeah, so he used to be down here, now he's up with us. Derek and her, two very young people, helping to lead the group in finding its mission. And Zach was a big part of that in helping, he just kept asking questions to draw out where they saw God at work, where their hearts were prone to go, where a door might be open, and then they came to it in one night. So sometimes it's just you coaching them to find it. And it's right in front of them, they just have never thought about it. So, yes. So as long as they don't see their brokenness as their identity. So like for instance, the problem with Alcoholics Anonymous, I'm not saying that that's what you're affirming, but the problem with is everyone remains an alcoholic. And the way it would be redeemed by the church is to say, hi, I'm Jeff. My identity used to be an alcoholic. I still don't drink alcohol because it's a challenge for me. But now I'm a son of God, redeemed by Jesus Christ. And I want to help other alcoholics become children of God. So if they had a new identity, not in their brokenness, but in Jesus Christ, and then they wanted to help others whose identity was in their brokenness move from that to being changed by Jesus Christ, then it would be more like a missional community. But if it's we're going to continue to be a support group and remain in our brokenness, but not see anybody changed as a result, then that would be not a missional community. Yeah. And that's a really important distinction because one becomes very focused on me and the other becomes focused on Christ and others as I'm growing up into Christ's likeness and being healed. So, yes. So do I see the Sunday gathering diminishing? It's hard to tell. I did find that it became less important to some people because as they got more on mission with each other, in a sense, they found their church really living that out there. So we had 120% involvement in missional community proportionate to our gathering. That makes sense. So at one point there were about 1,000 people in missional community and about 750 in our gathering. So that's most churches are the other way. Like they're trying to get their people in groups. We were the opposite because that became more important than the gathering for us, which meant there's a whole bunch of non-Christians who will never come to a church gathering who are in those missional communities, which is awesome. Right? That's what we're going to have to do, by the way. You guys, if you're smelling the wind, like it's telling you the millennials aren't going to go to church. A lot of them aren't going to go. And so you've got to really think through how you're going to recapture what it means to go be the church to reach them. In fact, in some ways, they're asking what good is the church if it doesn't bring change to the world? That's one of the biggest cries they're having against the church. They want a social activism that the church gets serious about. We've got to bring the gospel into the middle of that so it doesn't just become social activism devoid of the gospel. But we did find that. We did find, though, too, is that they would start new missional communities, and then they would multiply, and they'd say, can we gather together because we miss each other? So it was like a family reunion, and that's how some of our churches got planted. So they would start new churches, what they do. And then they want to gather because they missed each other. But there was a depth to that gathering. If you can imagine having gone through all that growth together, you're like, man, I want to see my brothers and sisters. Like, we're on mission all week long. Let's get together and pray and worship Jesus. And there's nothing like being with a group of people who are on mission all week long when they worship Jesus in song and prayer. I mean, it's powerful. And you can feel it. Like, there's just something here that's really amazing because they're really giving their lives for the gospel. So yeah, I don't know that it'll ever go away because Hebrews 10 says, do not give up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing. And I find that when a missional community tries to exist alone, like I'm not a house church guy in the sense that I'm not for a house church just meeting by itself for a long time because I think they're missing out on some of the gifts of the larger body and the strength that others could bring to them that could help them, encourage them. Because sometimes a house church goes through a really hard season and they need others to encourage them. So I would want them to be connected with people and maybe once a month would be okay then at that point. So we're going to start doing the other. We're going to start saying as missional communities multiply and form what we're going to call city groups, We're going to encourage them to gather once a month on their own, start to do some of the 1 Corinthians 12 through 14 expression of the church that you can't do in a much larger gathering, so they can start to grow in using their gifts with each other and maybe see that start a new church someday. So we're going to start doing it once a month at some point when they're ready. So, yes. So the question is, what priority would I put on establishing elders before you make this transition if you don't presently already have elders in place? A very high priority. But I wouldn't put it in such a way that I expect the one to happen before the other. I would just say, I've got to actually call some people to be elders, which means I'd probably say, I'm going to start training you in how to lead a missional community so that you can eventually be an example to the flock of the very thing that we're going to call the flock to do. So if I see a few that are ready to be put into that process of training, I'd tell them probably a 1 or 2 year process before you could probably become an elder, no guarantee. But you're going to have to show proof of making disciples who make disciples, show that you can oversee a household of faith, which is a missional community, like those kinds of things. So I would let that be the training toward it, but I wouldn't go forward without having a plan to train toward it. And the reason why is because otherwise all the leadership falls on one person usually. And that's very dangerous. Like I think it's so foolish to have any church led by one person. I don't see any biblical paradigm for it. I think it's going to set you up for a failure. If that person fails, the church is done. Like, I think there's wisdom in following Paul's admonition to appoint elders in the word. It's plural, not singular, when he says it. So, yeah. Yeah, so I use the word elders, not deacons. We have elders and deacons. For us, elders are the ones who are devoted to be an example of the flock, to shepherd and oversee the flock, to teach doctrine and refute false doctrine, and ultimately ensure that the flock is living out the purposes of God in terms of oversight. The diaconal, when we don't put them like this, by the way, we put them like this, side by side. Now, we believe there's oversight in terms of the elders, but we still treat them as equal, as an office that's very significant in the church. Not like you're the junior staff and you're the varsity staff. I don't do that. It's like, you're called to unique works of service, to be lead servants to the body, to lead the rest of the body into service. And that can be something in the city, it can be something in the building, it can be something, but whatever helps serve the body, that administrative for ministry, so we can get more ministry accomplished in terms of mercy and justice especially, but also in terms of administration so that we can support more work to be done. That's what we do with our deacons. So, all right. That's a lot of stuff, wasn't it? You guys are going like, we're full, no more. So it's 4:11. I'll probably let you go now. Can I pray for you? And can I just encourage you more than anything else, love Jesus' church like Jesus loves it. Pray that he gives you his heart for the body. Don't despise them. Don't think that they're in your way. They're in the way of Jesus. They're right where he wants you to go. He put you there for a reason. So love them and care for them and shepherd them gently like elders and leaders are called to do. So let me pray for you. Father, I thank you so much for this group of people and their desire to honor you, Jesus. I pray that you give them great wisdom. Every situation and context is completely different. There's no one size fits all to any of this. But I pray that you would grant that they would have taken away the things they needed, that you wanted to sit deep in their heart, that you would give them the way in which you want them to work out what you want for your church. And Lord, we pray that you'd help all of us to care for and shepherd the flock under the care you've given to us. We want to honor you, Jesus. You're the chief shepherd. You're the head of the church. This is for your fame and glory, not ours. So Lord, be honored, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.